Good morning.
Good morning.
In the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, welcome to this time of worship as we celebrate Christ on this gorgeous Sunday morning. We are glad you are here worshiping our Lord in spirit and in truth. It's great to have everybody, especially those who are visiting with us. If I would please sign the visitation pad located in the pew rack so that we may greet you by name after worship. There's an awful lot going on in the life of our church here this coming week, so please note everything in the bulletin, but I did want to highlight a few. If you would like to go to the North Coast District Spring Conference, it's at 3 o'clock this afternoon at Lakeshore United Methodist Church in Avon Lake, Ohio. I'll be going. If you want to go with me, let me know, and we can drive together. Also, this evening at 6 o'clock is the youth group meeting. At 7 o'clock, they're going to have a special guest, and all are invited. Jim Zakas, who is the head of the Nehemiah Mission Project here in Cleveland, will be speaking. So if you'd like to know a little bit more about some of the ministries that are going on in the United Methodist Church locally, come this evening at 7 o'clock and listen to Jim. He is quite an inspiring speaker. We also have a roast beef dinner tickets for sale down the hall. And with roast beef next week, there's also going to be a bake sale. And then on the 25th of April, Dee Dee Hefner from the McCurdy School in New Mexico will be here to offer a presentation as well. I say there's an awful lot going on in our church. Please note those things and celebrate all the ministries going on. Have a couple of people might need to come up. Johanna.
Good morning. I just want to call your attention to a table full of dishes down in front of Diane's office. These items have been around here for 6 months, 7 months, 8 months. We really would like to have you take them home if you can, if they belong to you. And if you have been missing something or a crock pot lid, there are some of those down there too. If these items are not claimed within the next 2 weeks, when the rummage sale comes, that's where they're going, and then you'd have to come to the rummage sale and buy it. So it would be much better if you
buy back your dishes.
It would be much better if you took them home today. Thank you.
Thanks, Johanna. Is Michael Kelly here? Yeah, rummage sale is May 4th, and so please put that on your calendar. A lot of good stuff comes through that. That'll help support the ongoing ministry through our mission team. Here's Michael Kelly.
Training a new video person, I almost forgot. She's just a part-time though, so we still need a video person. Anyhow, for those of you that don't know me, I'm Michael Kelly and I'm chairman of the Board of Trustees. So I have an announcement from the trustees. Under the direction of our district superintendent, a church conference has been called to consider and vote on a proposal from our Board of Trustees to sell the church parsonage. It has been determined that it is more cost effective in the long run for the church to offer our pastor a housing allowance rather than a church-owned home. This church conference will be next Sunday, the 21st, at 12:30 here in the sanctuary. All members of Fields are asked to come and attend to cast a vote as to whether or not we sell the parsonage. The church conference will be convened by our own Dr. Tom Joyce and run by the Board of Trustees. All members of Fields United Methodist Church are encouraged to come as we, the body of Christ, strive to be faithful stewards of all God has given us. If you have any questions, please see me as chairman of the Board of Trustees. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. Larry, let's worship.
Morning.
Oh, I forgot. The money guy. But it's good news.
Tom said, we do have some good news. You probably will remember that in January and February, Liz Simmons announced that we were running a significant deficit for those first 2 months of the year. Fortunately, we had a tremendous March. We had a great, great, great Easter offering. We've rebounded quite a bit where we were running a deficit of $3,000 or $4,000 for the first 2 months of the year. We're down to less than $2,000. So things are on the rebound. And as always, we thank you folks for your giving, your caring, and your love for this church. And with God's help, we'll continue to work to financially support this church the way we know it can be. And thank you very much for your help.
Thank you, Dave. God is good.
So with the Holy Spirit, then, that would be a windfall, right?
Yes.
Okay, good.
Okay.
Father, we praise you for that. You can turn my mic down a little bit, Michael, please. We praise you for that, Lord, and we thank you that you're operating in our midst. We ask that as this service goes today, that you would be glorified in this room. We ask, Lord God, that you would be the God that touches each of our hearts. Father, we ask that you would stir us up and help us to stir ourselves up, and we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
The power of prayer and the power of faith is incredible. Jesus said, according to the Gospel of Mark, "Truly I tell you, if you say to this mountain, be taken up and thrown into the sea, and if you do not doubt in your heart, but believe that what you say will come to pass, it will be done for you. So I tell you, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe that you have received it, and it will be yours." I mean, that's affirmation of God's presence in our prayers and in our lives. So let's
Amen.
Worship.
Amen. Let's call him up. Stand with us, will you? Please. And if your feet fail you, just sit back down.
If you confess the Lord, call him up. 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 If you believe on the Father, the Son, and the
Blessed be your name.
my heart will choose to sail. Blessed be your name. Give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be your name.
Let's say hi to someone. Let's tell someone we love them and we appreciate them.
I love you guys.
Love you,
I appreciate you guys.
I love you.
Dick's been working out. What is it?
Revelations. It's in the back. I already marked it.
Appreciate you guys. Huh? Appreciate you guys.
We appreciate you, Larry.
Today's scripture reading comes from the book of Revelations, chapter 5, verses 11 through 14. And it reads, "Then I looked and I heard the voice of many angels, numbering thousands upon thousands and 10,000s times 10,000. They encircled the throne and the living creatures and the elders. In a loud voice they sang, 'Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise.' Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and on the sea and all that is in them singing, 'To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise, glory, honor, power forever and ever.' The four living creatures said, 'Amen,' and the elders fell down and worshiped."
He knows my name. Falls.
Our Lord hears us, knows our thoughts, and responds to our prayers. And we have a good God. We have a gracious God. We have a God that's with us no matter what. And that's why we give God the glory, all the time. It is a joy to be in God's house this day. As you heard at the beginning, there's a lot going on in God's house here. And so celebrate those things and become a part of those things. It's great to have folks visiting with us for the first time. Glad you're here and worshiping with us. And if you have any questions, just ask somebody, because I'm sure there's a lot of excitement going on here at Fields United Methodist Church. There's also a lot of things we need to lift up to God in prayer for, because there's a lot of things that we just can't handle on our own. In fact, we can't handle anything on our own without the Lord of Lords and King of Kings and right by our side. So please note those things on the prayer list. And wanted to add a couple if I could. If you could please pray for Gary, for Tracy and Kenny, and the Riffon family. The wife went in for surgery on Thursday, and her husband went in for emergency surgery on Friday. And so that family is deeply struggling, so please pray for them. Also, if you would please pray for the family and friends of Lee. Lee passed away this past week. And before I forget, thank you, Larry, for preaching in my stead last week. I'm glad you were here and feeding the saints here last week. A lot of good things, like I say. Are there any other joys, concerns of the church here this morning? What's that? Oh, yeah, the wedding. We celebrate Nicole and Ken's wedding yesterday. That's part of the wedding here in the flowers. It was a grand time to behold. So it was. We celebrate them this day.
On behalf of Bob and myself and our whole family, we just want to thank everyone for their thoughts and prayers during trials and tribulations here in the last few months and last couple weeks. Our oldest son was involved in a motorcycle accident 2 weeks ago and suffered severe head injuries. He remains in intensive care in Akron General Hospital. But baby steps. He's in a semi-conscious condition at this point. We'll follow a few simple commands intermittently. And then our second oldest son, who was diagnosed in November with stage 4 pancreatic cancer, he's hanging tough. And I take him in weekly for chemotherapy, University Hospital Seidman Center. And like I say, we're just taking things a day at a time, and so appreciate everyone's love, thoughts, and prayers. It just means so much.
Norma and Bob, you know we're going to keep praying and keep hoping, and we're with your family. All the time. Anyone else?
After 3 months of looking, my husband finally found a job.
All right. A celebration. Good stuff. Okay. Let us go to God in silent prayer. Lord God, this morning we come and celebrate you and all the things that you have surrounded us with, the blessing of family, the blessing of friends, the blessings of new beginnings, and those who have just been married, and we just celebrate so much the joy that you offer to us, the spirit that enlivens our souls. We come here, Lord, because it's all because of you. It's all because you guide us, you strengthen us, you lift us up when we fall, and you dust off the dust of this world, Lord God, to give us a new beginning. And for that, we give you thanks and praise. Lord God, we celebrate this day. We celebrate all those who are with us this morning and all the ministries that you call us to. Lord God, we gather here with a whole lot of joy. But at the same time, we know that all is not well in your world. Lord God, we pray for all of those who are struggling with wars or talk of war throughout your world, Lord God. We just pray that your Spirit will intercede in those places and peace will overtake those harsh words of war. Lord God, we do pray for our great nation. We pray for our leaders. We pray for our community leaders. Lord God, we pray for our schools and our teachers, support staff, administrators, and we pray for our children, Lord God, for you have called us to let the children come and do not hinder them, and we will keep them eternally in our thoughts and prayers, Lord God. And we pray for parents, and we pray for friends and family. We pray for our neighbor, those we know and those we don't know, but Lord God, you love them just the same, and we pray your watch care upon all. Lord God, we pray for those who can't be here this day, those who are struggling, those who are traveling, travel blessings upon them. Lord God, we pray for those who are anxious in their faith, who are frustrated, Lord, who haven't heard the good news of the saving grace of our Lord Jesus Christ in their life. Lord, we do pray for those who mourn the loss of loved ones this day. Especially, we lift up to you the family and friends of Bonnie Stefanis and also the family and friends of Lee. Lord God, we just pray your Holy Spirit upon those folks who grieve, that their tears of loss may turn to tears of joy, knowing that their loved one is firmly within your grasp, and that there will be a day that they shall be rejoined with them and all the other saints who have gone on before them. Lord God, we lift up to you also Gary and Jim and Denise, for Kevin and Rose, Lenore, for Norma, for Tracy, for Kenny, for Dale, and for Terry and the Fortune family, for Richard, for Pat, for Ted, for the Riffon family, and for all of those others, we lift it up to you in prayer and deep within our hearts. Lord God, we just pray your Holy Spirit sanctify them in your truth, heal their bodies, and nourish their faith. And now, Lord God, we pray for each other and for ourselves that we may be enlivened by your Holy Spirit to continue the good work that you have begun in each and every one of us. These things we pray through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who offered us all so that we may have all, and calls us to pray together, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now, Lord God, bless the gifts that you will be receiving here this morning. Bless them and multiply them to your ministry. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us now offer our tithes and our offering.
Shackled by a heavy burden,
sing with me.
Neath the load of guilt and shame, then the hand of Jesus touched me. Since I met this blessed
donations. Lots of food, huh? Donations, yep. Good morning.
Good morning.
How are you?
Good.
Good. Week? Yeah. Yes? I did too. I had a busy week. Who had a busy week? No, nobody did. I did. Let's talk about prayer. When we pray, what are we doing? What are we doing? Okay. Good. That's an example of what we can say, but what's happening when we're praying? We're talking to God. We're talking with God. What do we do with our bodies sometimes when we pray? What are a couple things we do? Close our eyes sometimes. What else? Put our hands together. Benjamin, what kind of bugs you about praying? You don't like it sometimes when people do what? Or when you... What don't you like to do when you pray? Close your eyes. Yeah, Ben doesn't like to close his eyes. Raise your hand if you don't like to close your eyes when you pray. Because you just see dark stuff, and that's no fun. And Ben does not like to miss a beat. So... You're right. So do we have to close our eyes when we pray? Is there a rule that says we have to close our eyes when we pray? You're right. You can talk to God whenever you want. Sometimes I talk to God when I'm driving in the car. You're right. You know, people close their eyes, I think, so that they can focus more on God. God doesn't really care how we pray, how we talk to him, as long as he's at the center and he's at the focus of our conversation with him. You can talk to God while you're on the school bus. Who rides the school bus to school in the mornings? You don't ride the school bus, you're too little still. You can talk to God on the school bus. You can talk to God while you're eating your lunch. You can talk to God while you're laying in bed at night and while you're brushing your teeth in the morning. You sure can. You guys like to talk, though. I'm sure you could cut some time out to talk to God. Anyhow, let's have a prayer, and you don't have to fold your hands. You don't have to close your eyes. Just as long as you put God in your mind, we can have a prayer with him. We can talk to him and say, thank you, Lord, for always being there. Our song today told us that you know our every thought, and we don't have to close our eyes. We don't have to fold our hands for you to hear what's in our hearts and in our minds. Lord, be with us as we begin another week. And all of God's children said, amen. You're going to pray? Okay. Have a great day at Sunday school.
You want to see and hear the Holy Spirit working? We just did. Let us pray. Lord God, we celebrate you this day, and we pray your continued presence of your Holy Spirit as we read this scripture and proclaim your message, that we may be filled with hope, renewal, and the salvation of our souls. Lord God, may your word come through me or in spite of me. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The gospel lesson this morning is from St. John's Gospel, the 21st chapter, beginning in the 15th verse. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? He said to him, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus said to him, feed my lambs. A second time he said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? He said to him, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus said to him, tend my sheep. He said to him a third time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Now Peter felt hurt because he said to him the third time, do you love me? And he said to him, Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you. Jesus said to him, feed my sheep. Very truly I tell you, when you were younger, you used to fasten your own belt and go wherever you wished. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will fasten a belt around you and take you where you do not wish to go. He said this to indicate the kind of death by which he would glorify God. After this, he said to Peter, "Follow me." I thought that Jesus asked a pretty straightforward question. Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? Now, we don't know what these or who these were, but Peter had an answer. Peter had that pat answer. Peter thought that he would put these words together. And so they rolled right off his tongue. "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." But I have a sense that Peter really wasn't listening to Jesus' response. For a second time, Jesus asked Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" And Peter said, "Yep, I love you. And tend my sheep." And then a third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Now, Peter thought that this "I love you" phrase was sufficient. That's all he needed. For it was pretty obvious that Peter loved Jesus because he wore a cross around his neck. He went to church on Sunday. He had Jesus tattooed on his forearm. He must love Jesus. Isn't that enough? Peter put on a good show, had all the right words. And in his mind, he thought he made it. Yet Jesus was asking him more, for more than just lip service. A few words. Jesus wanted him to go the next step. For to say, "I love you," to our spouses or to those that we love dearly is more, and especially Jesus, is more than simple platitude. It's more than just words. It's more than just a phrase to say. It is a verb. To say we love someone means that there's a dynamic action that reaches beyond our opinions, our judgments, our hang-ups, even our fears. To say that we love somebody means that every part of us wants to do whatever we can to care for them, to reach out. I was listening to a radio program one morning last week, and there's the question that came up was, what does your spouse do that really irritates you? I see all the husbands out there saying, "Now what's he going to say?" And I thought about that. I said, you know, I'll have to say honestly, this is before God and before all of you, nothing irritates me. I just love her. And that's true. You see, when we put all of our stuff aside, we start setting that stuff to the side and we just start caring for the people we care about in our lives. We start truly loving the people that we love in our lives. Because saying, "I love you," without any action, it's like saying, "Let me help you move this piano," and walk the other way. Ever have somebody do that? "I'll be happy to help you." And you look around, where'd they go? Now, to say "I love you" is setting ourselves in motion. Last weekend, got up early in the morning, as I always do. Didn't realize I was in a different time zone, and that kind of set me off a little bit. Sitting around the kitchen table and saying, "Boy, I should go out and take a walk." Thought about it a few more minutes. "Man, I should go out and take a walk." A few more minutes. You know what? A walk would be a great thing to do. And then I was talking to myself and to the dog. I felt that there's something missing. You know what was missing? The walk. So I got up and I walked and I experienced the joy of a sunrise, the joy of the dew, the joy of the birds starting to sing, the joy of folks just starting to walk around. There are not too many people out at 6 o'clock, 5:30, 6 o'clock on a Saturday morning, but you know, it was fantastic. You see, if all we do is talk, we don't experience the reality of life. And so Jesus was calling Peter, as Jesus is calling us, to live the talk. Live the profession that we have. You see, Peter did talk a good talk, didn't he? I'm saying, yeah, Jesus, I love you. But Jesus just badgered him. Said, whoa, wait a minute. I don't think you do. I don't think you get this game. When you say I love you, that means you've set your heart, your mind, and soul in motion to reach out to the least and the lost. You've heard the phrase, talk is cheap. Maybe that's what Jesus was saying. James says in his letter, faith without works is dead. You see, when we have faith, when we're enlivened by the Spirit that we felt here this morning, we start doing stuff, not because we have to, but because we want to. You see, Jesus was adamant about people. Didn't care so much about institutions, didn't care so much about policies and procedures, but was adamant about people. You know, when the disciples were gathered and there's about 5,000 people that were around him and were hungry, what did Jesus want to do? Feed them. And so he looked at his disciples and said, hey, these folks are hungry, feed them. And then the disciples started stammering and said, how can we feed 5,000 people? What did Jesus say to them? Feed them. Then they started going off again. You know, we don't have enough. You know, the caterer's not here yet and all that kind of stuff. What did Jesus say? Feed them. Jesus is adamant about people, about where they are, about how they feel, their souls. When Jesus says, come all who are weary and carrying heavy burdens, he means all, everybody. Not one being left behind. Loving Jesus means having compassion for our neighbor. Not pity, but compassion. You see, for Jesus, it's not about a cause. I don't think Jesus took the time to make posters and protest. Jesus just did it for another. Sometimes we can get so wrapped up in the doing that we forget who we are doing it for. And that is our brothers and sisters. Sometimes we get so busy qualifying who we should help and who we should talk to and how we should do it that we miss opportunities to share the grace of God. We judge. It's not our place to judge someone's worth before God. That's up to God. But our place is to reach out to the least and the lost, to those who are estranged, those who may not come up to our standard, whatever that might be. We're called to do. Living the talk, and not just talking, is to understand that we are all equal in the sight of God. Every last one of us are equal. None of us are closer to the throne of grace than anybody else. I don't know about you, but that's a good place to be. Saints, we're all in the same boat. We're all in the same boat. It takes courage, though, to stand up. It takes courage to say, I love you, and then to do something about it. It takes courage to step up and be counted. And not just to say a few words that might make people feel better, but actually reach out and make them feel better. Any relationship that we hold dear to us, especially those relationships that we bless with the words, I love you, comes with the joy of serving and is a relationship based not on saying, but on doing. For what we do gives God glory. I wanted to tell you a story about 10, 15 years ago. A tragedy happened, and a brother passed away, and the sister came to me and said, Preacher, you know, my brother's going to hell. I said, oh, why do you say that? Well, he never professed his faith in Jesus Christ to me. I said, oh, what kind of guy was he? Well, he was in church every Sunday. He loved to teach Sunday school. He loved the Word of God. He loved to really teach the Word of God to people. He always wanted to help. He was always there when the doors opened, when they closed, kind of drove us crazy every once in a while, but he was always there, always a kind word for somebody else. And if I wasn't a preacher, I would have grabbed her by the neck. And said he was professing his faith to you by what he was doing. Do you think he has to say it? He was witnessing the good news in his life. He was professing his faith in what he was doing. He put his faith and trust in the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords and realized that every step that he took was a blessing from God, and he told you that. Don't you think that's a profession of faith? It's amazing sometimes. We need to hear the words, and sometimes we do need to hear the words, but we need to live the words that we say. We need to live the faith that we proclaim. Last Thursday evening was a holy time in Bible study. You're welcome to come. 7 o'clock Thursday evenings, we have a hoot. It's fun. But I asked the folk, who is this Jesus? What does Jesus represent to you? Because if we're going to live a faith and live the talk, we need to know what we're professing. Folks didn't take too much time to think about it. To some, Jesus represented grace. To others, mercy. To others, peace. To others, joy. To others, mission. You know, the Lord that we serve represents all those things. And all those things require us to do more than just talk. Requires us to do. Requires our whole life to be this dynamic working of the Holy Spirit within us. It's a fun thing to do. It's a hoot to do. It's a joy to be in the faith, isn't it? Someone say amen to that. All right. It's a joy to be in the faith. It's a joy to witness the good news of the saving grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. It is a joy. It should be a fun. It should be a hoot. That's what Jesus was after when talking to Peter. When Jesus said, feed my lambs, it's a joy to feed the lambs. When Jesus said to tend the sheep, it's a joy to tend the sheep. I wouldn't know how to tend the sheep at all, but it would be a joy if I knew. You see, that's what we're called to be. We're called to be a house set upon a hill. We're called to be a vehicle, of God's grace and God's mercy and God's peace in the world, we're not just called to talk about it, we're called to do it. So that is the joy of faith. So as we leave this place, consider your own life. Consider what you profess. Live what you profess. And you will be glorified by God as you give glory to God to the people around you. Let us pray. Lord God, we give you thanks for giving us the word that became flesh and dwelled among us. We give you thanks for the privilege of serving you, the privilege of witnessing the good news of you in our lives, Lord God. Continue to bless us, keep us, give us the joy of believing, and help us to reach out to all those who seek a closer relationship to you, and help us to love not only you, but those around us with all that we have. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ offered himself to us, offered everything that we may live a new life. And so this morning, we celebrate the sacrament of Holy Communion. This is not the table of Fields United Methodist Church, nor the United Methodist Church. This is the table of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And all are welcome here. All who seek a closer relationship with God and with one another. And so we come humbly, acknowledging our own human faults, asking God's forgiveness to cleanse us of the unrighteousness, that we may come to this table with joy. And so come to this place. Let us pray. Lord God, we give you thanks for the word. We give you thanks for the prophets that brought us the word that became flesh and has dwelled among us. Lord, as you met with all those throughout your ministry, you met with the sinners, you met with all those who were cast off, but you didn't cast them off, Lord. And as you met with them, you have met with us. And on the night in which you gave him yourself up for us, you took a loaf of bread, giving thanks, blessed it, and broke it, and said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Take and eat." When the supper had ended, he took the cup. Again, giving thanks to you, blessed it, and said, "This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Take and drink." Now, Lord God, pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and wine, make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. Will those helping with communion please come forward? He's my Savior. 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 Our Lord and our God, our Savior, we give you thanks for this gift of everlasting life. As we partake of this bread and this wine, your blood and your body, that we may be filled with your Spirit, filled with your power, your love, and your joy, and we go from this place blessed. In Jesus' name, amen.
Stand with us, please.
His love endures forever.
God of all strength, grace, peace, and power go with you today and equip you in all that you set your hand to. May he impel your heart to think big, to dream big, to trust him in all the things that he's called you to do, that you would say yes and amen. My God is with me. Nothing is impossible. Amen. In Jesus' name. See you next week.